Cool. Thank you. Cool. Thank you, Tyler, for that warm and introduction that sets me up to fail for the rest of the talk. No, but I want to thank Tyler and Emma and everyone else who brought me here. It's really fun to be here, and I appreciate the opportunity to share my work with you today. So what I'm going to talk about is the book that Tyler mentioned. So I've been working on this book for the past maybe 5 years, called Bit by Bit, Social Research in the Digital Age. And the book is for social scientists that want to do more data scientists that want to do more social science, and anyone interested in the hybrid of these fields. So I spend time in both of these communities, and I see them each having a lot to offer the other, and each having a lot to learn. But they're not really in as much contact as I think they could be and should be. And so it's like you have sort of two friends that you know would hit it off, and so you want to have a party so that they can come and meet each other, and this is sort of what I'm trying to do with this book. One of the things that people ask when I describe my book this way is, what is a data scientist? And here I would just ask you all whatever you think is a data scientist. I'm happy with that. Sometimes I say, well, it's whatever is cool. But in general, I think it's good not to try to, when you have something that's new and emerging, it's not good to try to build walls around it at the beginning. It's just good to take a big tent approach at the beginning and let things evolve, and then you can get into some of those issues later. More specifically, with regard to social science, there's now, I see increasing number of social scientists who are using some techniques that were developed by computational scientists, people in computer science, applied math, and engineering. And so there I see that flow this way. And I also see some people in computer science who are starting to work more with social data. And so they bring a lot of training and ideas from computer science. But now that they're working with social data, they're entering the world of social science. So this is where I see a lot of opportunity for mutually beneficial discussions. During the process of working on this, another question I got all the time was this one, which is, isn't computational social science just a fad? And here I have a very simple answer, which is no. There are lots of academic fads in the world. I know there are in sociology. I would imagine there may be in your field as well. I see computational social science differently because I see it as being driven by a fundamental change in the world. So we have this transition from sort of the analog age to the digital age. This transition is happening. It is real. It is not going away. This is the driver of what's happening, and this is our opportunity to take advantage of these new capabilities that didn't really exist before. Now, that is not to say that there is not some fad-like elements to what's happening. And so I like to think about this in terms of this graph, which is called the hype cycle. So this is a graph that was developed by Gartner Research, like a market research firm. And this is the way they describe new technologies diffusing through a space. So the x-axis here is time. The y-axis is visibility. So initially something happens, and then you get this peak of inflated expectations where everyone says, oh, big data is going to make everyone happy and cure cancer and end poverty and all of this other stuff. And then that turns out not to be true. And then people enter this trough of despair where they think, oh, nothing is ever, this is not good for anything. And then eventually they figure out, no, you know, it's pretty good for some things. And it just becomes a normal part of how they do their work. So I think the book, what I'm trying to do is push down that peak, pull up the trough, and then get to that plateau as quickly as possible. So from my perspective as a sociologist, I do want to say something about what I think this plateau will look like. What is the end goal that we're trying to get to? So it's my hope that eventually computational social science, what we're now calling computational social science, will just be called social science. Right? So I think the ultimate success of these approaches will come when they are normalized into the regular ways that social scientists and sociologists do their work. I think there will always be an opportunity and kind of a frontier in people interacting with the newest and most cutting-edge things that are possible. So what is 10 years from now, there will be some new edge of what is computational social science, and then hopefully 10 years after that, that will become a normal thing again. So I think the hope for computational social science is to normalize, not to separate. Also, I think it's important to clarify that I don't think this should change our goals as sociologists. So our goals are about understanding the social world, and this is a new means to achieve our goals, but it doesn't change what our goals are. So I think if you think about like an x-ray machine and a doctor. So a doctor's goal is to help her patients. X-ray machine doesn't change the goal of the doctor, it just helps the doctor do her work better. So this is the same way I think about big data and computational social science. It doesn't change what we're trying to do, it helps us do things better. And also, it doesn't displace all other methods. So just because a doctor has an x-ray machine doesn't mean that she would never talk to one of her patients. That would be silly. An x-ray machine is just part of one of the suite of things that you have to do your work better. So that's what I think this plateau will look like. So in the process of the book, I've come to sort of have a couple of high-level ideas about what are some ideas that social scientists can especially contribute to data scientists, and what are some ideas that data scientists can especially contribute to social scientists? So I'm going to talk about those ideas in a kind of very high-level way, and then I'll give you some more specific examples of them. But this is also the part of the talk where I kind of insult both social scientists and data scientists, because I speak about them as large, undifferentiated groups who have things to learn from someone else. So just please know that I mean these ideas in the most positive and constructive way possible. Just so I can get a sense of the audience, though, how many people would identify themselves as social scientists? Cool. How many would identify themselves as data scientists? Cool. I saw some people do both, and I saw some people do neither. That's cool, too. So this is great. So this is actually really exciting to me that we have such a mixed audience. I think it's a really nice thing that the eSciences Institute is doing to create communities like this. Okay, so I think if I could think of one sort of metaphor to illustrate what I think a lot of data science is, it's kind of this urinal. So this is not just any urinal. You all recognize that is a very special urinal. That's Fountain by Duchamp. And I think that the process that Duchamp went through to create this beautiful piece of art reminds me of the process I see happening a lot in data science. So Duchamp was walking around in New York. He saw this urinal, and he realized that this thing that was created for one purpose can be repurposed for a different purpose. This thing that was originally created as a urinal is actually a piece of art. And so I think a lot of data science follows that pattern. You have data that are created by companies or businesses to achieve the goals of those companies and businesses. And then a lot of data scientists can be very clever at repurposing that data for research. So you have data that was never created for research, but then through a very clever repurposing can fundamentally even change what you think is possible for research. So like, this is a beautiful thing because it changed what people think is even possible for art. And I think that the best forms of data science really cause sociologists to think again about what it is that we can and should be doing. If you had to think of the sort of style that might better capture social scientists, I would think it would be this, Michelangelo. So he didn't say, like, I want to create David, so I'm going to look around for a piece of stone that looks kind of like David. He spent 3 years working in the marble to create exactly the data or the David that he wanted. So you can sort of contrast this style of the ready-made style of a data scientist and the custom-made style of a social scientist. Now, increasingly, both of these pure styles are going to run into problems. So for social scientists who are used to saying, I don't want to repurpose data, I have my theory, I want to collect exactly the data that I need for my theory, that is wonderful. But as the amount of ready-made data increases, it becomes increasingly difficult to ignore. And there are increasing opportunities for you to take advantage of this data, and particularly to combine these two sources of data. So we'll see some examples of people who, and likewise for people who are data scientists who want to keep using these ready-mades, you have probably already encountered in your own research there are real fundamental limitations to this ready-made data. And so by adding a small amount of custom-made data to it, you can actually unlock tons of value in it. And so I think this is one way that social scientists and data scientists can learn from each other and collaborate by combining this ready-made and custom-made data. A second thing has to do, So I think, actually, that this is a beautiful piece of art. This changed what people think is possible in art. And I mean it in a respectful way, and I'm sorry if you don't take it that way. Okay, a second idea that I think is important to keep in mind is that, in general, there's a difference in culture. Many social scientists would see this glass as half empty, and many data scientists would see this glass as half full. So I see a big cultural difference in the way that data scientists have a lot of energy and are willing to push ahead in ways that social scientists are sometimes hesitant to. And I think increasingly we'll need to see a combination of these styles. I think social scientists will need to be more willing to push ahead and try new things and adopt more of the maker mentality that you see among data scientists. So if you were going to write a book about computational social science that you would want to make sense 10 years from now, you run into the challenge that it's hard to organize all of this without making it about any specific technology that exists today. So there's a lot of stuff that exists today, and you could write a book about how to use Twitter data, but Twitter may be out of business in 5 years, maybe out of business in 3 years, for that matter. So what is the right abstraction that will make sense 5 years from now or 10 years from now? And so I think that abstraction is research design, which is a concept that all social scientists are trained in. And roughly, research design is sort of the recipe that you go through to connect your research question with the data that exists in the world. So it's different than statistics. It's something a little bit more abstract. So let me give you some examples. These are all designs that you've used in the past. So the book is organized around these four designs. The first is observing people's behavior. So this is what a lot of I see as big data research now. You basically just watch the world and see what happens. And now, to a social scientist or to a sociologist, that's like actually one of the weaker designs, because you're not intervening in the world in any way to create the data that you want. There are real limits to what you can learn by just setting up a camera and watching what everyone's doing. And that's what I see a lot of the big data research as doing. And so what I think is really exciting for the future is moving to stronger designs where the researcher has a bigger role in creating the data. So the next step down here is asking people questions. So now you're intervening in the world in a certain way to create the data that you want. Then the next step, stronger design, is running experiments. So here you deliver treatments to people through a randomization process. And you can learn things by running experiments that you can't learn by doing surveys. And you can learn things by doing surveys that you can't learn by just observing people's behavior. And then the final design is one that's less commonly used in social sciences now, but I think will be used increasingly, is creating mass collaborations. And so what I want to talk about now in this talk is these three designs that I see as being beyond big data. So I want to give you an example of people using the capabilities of the digital age to ask questions or run experiments or create mass collaborations in new ways. And there you'll see, through these examples, some of the themes I talked about in the beginning of the talk. Yeah, sure. Absolutely. So I think that's a great strategy for learning from observing behavior, is looking for these natural experiments that occur in this observed behavior. So I would think of that, it's different than running an experiment, because in that case, you don't get to design the treatment. The treatment is created by the government or the weather or whatever you use as your exogenous shock. And you don't get to decide where it goes, and you don't get to decide what you measure. But that, I think, is a good strategy. So I think one of the things that I talk about in the book, I'm not going to talk about observing behavior at all, but in the book, I do talk about strategies that you can use to get more out of the data other than just saying, this is what happens. And one of these is looking for these natural experiments Or doing matching is another strategy that you can use to try to approximate an experiment when one hasn't been done. Okay, so asking questions. So one of the questions I get a lot from data scientists when I tell them I'm interested in surveys is, well, why should I care about surveys? Surveys seem like the most boring thing in the world, especially when you're a participant in a survey. And the reason why I think you should care about surveys is because it turns out surveys are really useful. So this is something that a lot of quantitative social scientists have struggled with and come to this realization over time, that it's a really good way to learn about the world. And most of the knowledge that we have about the world quantitatively, a lot of it comes through surveys. So it's a very kind of fundamental measurement technology. It may be particularly boring, but it doesn't have to be. Like, there are ways that we can take surveys the way we've done them in the past and modernize them and make them more interesting and better. So then sometimes people say, okay, I'm kind of interested in surveys, but we don't need surveys because everything is automatically measured now. Like, the big data eliminates the need for surveys. And I think this is fundamentally wrong for a couple reasons. I think it's worth walking through these to clarify. So first is, there are real fundamental limitations to the kinds of information that's collected in this big data that's created by companies and businesses. So one of it comes from the fact that it's often not created for research, but it's repurposed. So FUBU stands for us, by us. It was a clothing company that was popular when I was in high school. So a lot of researcher-created data is FUBU, and a lot of data created by companies is NUFU, NUBU. So it's not for researchers, and it's not by researchers. So the things they collect and the way that they store their data, they're optimized around the goals of the company, which is very natural because that's what they're doing. And so sometimes they make choices that make it hard for us to use their data in the ways that we would like. This is something that's not going to change as technology changes. Fundamentally, the goals, in some cases the goals align, in some cases they're different, but this is a problem that's not going to go away automatically. Second is, there's an important difference between what I would call internal states and external states. So we can measure people's behavior through a lot of this automatically tracked big data, but there are a bunch of internal states, things like people's attitudes, emotions, expectations for the future. These are things that sociologists think are very important to understand in and of themselves and use to explain other kinds of things. And so if you want to learn about these internal states, it's often better to ask people directly. Finally, a lot of this big data, even if it exists, if you don't have access to it, it doesn't really matter for the purposes of your research. So here, I think my favorite example of this is this NSA data center in Utah, which may or may not have every email and phone call and web search and who knows what else is in there. I'm not going to have access to that data, so for the purposes of my research, that data does not exist. For other reasons, it may actually exist, and we'll come back to some of that, those issues at the end of the talk. Yeah? Yeah. Absolutely. So this, I sort of glossed over a huge challenge. So the question was about, how do you measure internal states with surveys? And I would say it's a huge challenge. And survey researchers have been working on it for a long time. And they have different things that they can do to try to do a better job. I could recommend some books. I mean, the short answer is, we don't totally know. We do know some things not to do, I would say. And I think this is something we can potentially get better at. So for example, let me give you a concrete example of how we can get better. There's something called ecological momentary assessment. So oftentimes a survey, they would ask you to make a recall about a very long period of time. So like, over the past month, how much pain have you felt? So this you might ask in a medical survey. So that's actually a hard thing to recall over the last month, how much pain have you felt. But now imagine if your cell phone buzzes at random times and they ask, how much pain do you feel right now? So this is potentially a much better way to measure internal states by reducing the recall period. And that's something that we can do much easier now given the infrastructure of the digital age. Okay, So I think we're always going to need to do surveys, but I think increasingly we're going to start to combine surveys with a lot of ready-made data. And the example I want to give of that was actually work that I think was started here at UW by Josh Blumenstock and some of his colleagues. So let me briefly explain the problem here. So what they wanted to do, so let's say you wanted to eliminate poverty. That seems like a goal that we would all share, poverty in the developing world. So one challenge you would run into is you need to be able to measure where the poverty is and how much poverty there is. And so in the US, we have good official statistics systems that are run by the government that track these kind of things. In a lot of developing countries, they don't have this data, and so it's very hard to even know where the where you should allocate your resources and how to track whether things are getting better over time. So there's kind of two broad ways that people try to address this problem. One is censuses and one is sample surveys. So with a census, you try to interview every single person in the country. And this is really good for giving you very granular, small area estimates for very small geographic areas or very small social groups. But the problem with censuses is they're very expensive, so there's very long time periods between them. And they're not very flexible. They usually have a small number of questions. So the main alternative is to do some kind of sample survey where you would interview like a randomly selected sample of 1,000 people. So those are much cheaper. You can do them more frequently. They're much more flexible because you don't need such a massive infrastructure to do them. But it's harder to get these small area estimates with sample surveys. And so what if now you could somehow combine these things and get kind of the best features of a census and the best features of a sample survey? Or another way of thinking about it is, what if you could essentially ask everyone in a country any question you want every day? Like, what if you could have a ubiquitous, always-on survey? So this would be a very powerful tool for public policy and for social research. So they did not actually do that. But they are moving in a step in that direction. So that's the sort of context for why I think this is a very important step on a very important problem. So let me tell you what they did do, which is a really good example, I think, of combining ready-made and custom-made data in a way that yields results that neither could have individually. So they started with call records from the largest mobile phone carrier in Rwanda. So they have data on 1.5 million people. Every call and text message they sent and received. This data does not have the thing that they actually care about, which is a measure of poverty. So they collected that. So they took a sample of 1,000 people, and they called them. This is call records, so they know their phone number. And they call them up, and they say, hey, we want to ask you some questions. They ask them a bunch of questions. They measure their poverty. And then they link the two data sources together. So first, what they do is they do a step called feature engineering. So this is a common data science idea. It's a little bit less common in social science now. So essentially, they create a matrix where there's one row for each person and one column for each feature, or variable, is the way a social scientist would say it. So an example of what these features could be is like a number of outgoing calls, ratio of outgoing calls to incoming calls, and so on. So they actually have a very interesting feature engineering thing, the way they do it. So one way you could do it is kind of a hand-coded approach, where you sort of think about what's important. You may have also seen these kind of more like deep learning approaches, where you try to learn the features automatically. So what they have is this very interesting hybrid of sort of combination of hand-coded features that are then sort of flexibly combined. It's very interesting. You should check out that part of the paper. So then what they do is they build a machine learning model that predicts someone's survey data from their call data. So here they use something like a lasso, but it turns out that a lot of the methods produce similar results. So then once you can predict someone's survey data from their call data, then they can essentially impute everyone's answer to the survey. So essentially, by asking this survey to 1,000 people and combining it with the call records, they can approximate asking the survey to 1.5 million people. Then the other thing they do is they estimate where everyone lives from the call records. So you can roughly look at the cell towers that you use at night and take like a weighted average of those, and that's a pretty good estimate of where you live. They do something a little bit more fancy, but that's roughly the idea. So now they have 1.5 million survey responses or imputed survey responses and a bunch of residence locations, and then they produce a very high resolution estimate of the distribution of poverty, and the estimate is so high resolution that it can't be checked with other estimates. But how would you then decide whether to have confidence in this estimate or not? So you do two different things, both of which are really important. So the first is a kind of cross-validation. So within the sample, they pretend they don't know people's survey data, and they try to estimate it from the other survey data. So here is the predicted wealth, and the y-axis is the actual wealth, and you can see there's some relationship. Maybe how good that is depends on, I think, what your perspective is. But it's clear there is some signal here. The R-squared is not high, but one of the other, wait. So I want to. No, no, this is the graph that I took from the paper. The paper has the R-squared. No, they put it in the paper. They definitely put it in the paper. So the other thing is that if you want estimates at the, like, let's say, county level, you don't necessarily need perfectly accurate individual level estimates. So I'll come back to this also about how well it's doing in a second. So some signal, whether it's a good or a bad signal, it's to be debated, certainly be improved. But then this is only in sample. So what we'd like to know is how well does this actually measure poverty in Rwanda? And here we're very lucky that there's something called the Demographic and Health Survey. So this is the gold standard way of measuring demographic and health information in developing countries. It is not perfect by any means, but it is the gold standard for what we can reasonably do. And they've done one of these in Rwanda, so we can compare how well the wealth that's measured in the Demographic and Health Survey at the sort of county level compares to how well they can estimate wealth at the county level using their technique. And this is the result. So the y-axis is the average household wealth from the Demographic and Health Survey. So this is the ground truth, or the gold standard. And this is the average predicted wealth from the call records. So now we're at the county level. So not perfect, not terrible. So now comes the last thing that I think is particularly exciting about their method. So it clearly does something. Probably doesn't work as well as we'd like, but it's 10 times faster and 50 times cheaper. So 50 times cheaper, I think it's not just an end in itself. I don't think we should just cut the budget for the Demographic and Health Survey by a factor of 50. But what I would love is 50 times more Demographic and Health Surveys. So rather than doing the Demographic and Health Survey every 5 years, what if we did it every month? So in the US, we don't measure unemployment every 5 years. We measure it every month. And so one, we could get higher frequency data. And the other thing that this would enable is if there were lots of demographic and health surveys, it would be much easier to add questions onto the demographic and health survey. So I've actually tried to add questions to the demographic and health survey in Rwanda, and it is impossible. Everyone wants to add their questions to the demographic, not everyone, everyone in this community of people wants to add their questions to the demographic and health survey. So it's very difficult. But if there was a demographic and health survey going into the field every month, it would be much easier for people to add their modules into it. So to me, this is a very exciting way of taking advantage of this already existing data, enriching it with some custom-made data to do something that's not possible with either data source individually. And then in terms of the actual performance, I want to point out that this recipe is very general. So the way that the amount of survey data they collected here was actually quite small. It was only 1,000 people. And there's some results in the paper that suggest that if they had collected more data, this machine learning model would have worked better. It's also the case that you can potentially enrich. This doesn't just have to be call records. This could be any digital trace source that you have about people. So you can potentially add much more data over here. You can potentially add more data over here. And you could potentially do the sampling in a different way. I think if they had known exactly what they were going to do at the end, they might have done their sampling a little bit differently as well. So I think that this is potentially a very general, improvable approach. Okay, so that's a little bit about asking questions. What time is this supposed to end?
4:30.
Okay, so I am going to talk then a little bit about experiments. So I want to give now an example of a really cool experiment from the social sciences that was done fully in the analog age using analog techniques, I guess, analog infrastructure. And then I want to show how that experiment can be done differently in the digital age and what kinds of new things can be done. Also, I want to show how ideas about experimental design that social scientists have developed can be very helpful for data scientists who are doing a lot of experimentation and A/B testing and so on. So this is a fantastic paper by Schultz and colleague about the power of social norms. So it's about the effect of social norms on energy consumption. And so they had this idea that if we tell people about how much energy their neighbors are using, we can actually get them to use less energy. So the researchers went to these people's houses, observed how much energy they were using, then went back and calculated this kind of a graph, kind of like this, not exactly this graph, but a graph like this, and then went back to these people's houses and put door hangers showing how much energy people used compared to their energy-efficient neighbors and all their neighbors. And then they measured how much energy they used subsequently. Yes, yes, and in fact, I will talk about how that happened in a second. So I want to talk about where this idea came from, because that company didn't invent that idea. And I want to talk about how they even knew that this would work, because if you just look at the average effect of this intervention, it is zero. So these psychologists, though, they were more clever, and they thought a little bit more carefully before they had done this, and they realized that there was a possibility that actually this one average effect is actually two offsetting effects. And so if you split the data into people that are heavy users and light users, you see that actually for the heavy users, they did decrease their energy usage, but the light users actually increased. So people had thought, oh, I'm not using enough energy. I should use more energy. So this is an example of what the researchers call descriptive norms. So descriptive norms describe the behavior that other people are doing. And so here, descriptive norms have the potential to create this boomerang effect, or this two offsetting effects. They were aware of this, and they knew about this other kind of normative theory from the theory of norms called injunctive norms, where they added this here to show you not just what other people are doing, but what you should be doing. So when you add this, they say, oh, you're using less. That's a good thing. And then you see here, when you add that, the boomerang effect goes away. So through thinking about norms, what they're able to do is they're able to take a treatment. First of all, they're able to take a treatment that appears to have no effect and realize it has two offsetting effects. And then they're able to use this theory to create a new treatment which will have the desired effect. So here, theory is very valuable in a way. And it's hard to imagine how they would have gotten to this through just a series of blind A/B tests, right? Like, they didn't say, oh, you know what? Let's just try 41 different shades of this gray, right? They thought a little bit more about what actually might be happening, which allowed them to design this much more effective treatment. Also, it means that this treatment then, the knowledge that they gain from it, helps us advance the theory as well. So if they had just designed a bunch, chosen a bunch of colors, that wouldn't help make a contribution to this larger theoretical effort around understanding norms. So this was, I love this paper. This is a great paper. And then there's this company, Opower, that took this idea and they said, let's industrialize this. And they said, they realized, which is kind of natural, there's already companies that are measuring people's electricity usage. There's already companies that are sending people stuff every month. So basically, we have all this infrastructure. All the time that these graduate students have been walking to people's houses to look at their meters and stuff, that was not necessary anymore. All that infrastructure already existed. So once you industrialize this, you can run many, 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 many more experiments at basically zero variable cost. So what does that enable? So let me give you one example. This is a from a paper by Alcott. So subsequent to this, let me actually take a step back. So a lot of times in social science, or sociology at least, someone will do an experiment and they'll get a cool result and you'll be like, well, I wonder if that really is generalizable. Like, what if they did that again? Or what if they did that in a different location? Or what if they did that at a different time? And usually we never really get to know. That ends up being just speculation. Someone says, like Tyler's like, no, I think it would be different if they did it in Connecticut. And I'm like, no, it would be the same. And like, we never really find out. It's just kind of talking. But when you can industrialize these things and run them at very low cost, then you can do lots of them. And so this is a result from about 100 experiments that O-Power has done. The y-axis is the treatment effect. The x-axis here is time, the time that the experiment began. And so you see a couple patterns. First, you see that the treatment effect, the average treatment effect, is always above zero. So this experiment seems to hold true in lots of different places in the US, this result that they observed in this one setting. You also see this very strong downward trend. And so you may wonder, why is there this downward trend? And so in this paper, they go through a lot of stuff to try to figure it out. And one of the main things that the author thinks is that the utilities that decided to do this program first have different customers than the utilities that decide to do it later. So they call it site selection bias. So even if you do an experiment, if the place where that experiment happens is different than other places, then if you try to generalize from this first place that it happens, you're going to get the wrong estimate about what's going to happen when it's done in other places. So this is an example of, by being able to do these experiments at zero variable cost, we can learn this important thing about the way this process happens in many settings. So in general, like, there's this difference in cost structure between a lot of analog and digital experiments. So the x-axis here is cost. The y-axis is the number of participants. So usually, if you want to increase the number of participants, if you double your number of participants in an analog experiment, you're roughly your cost double. And if you want to do 10 times bigger experiment, your costs go up by a factor of 10. This makes it hard to do really big experiments. With digital experiments, there's often a much bigger fixed cost, but then the variable cost is basically zero, so you can run really massive experiments. And this allows you to assess this external validity, which we just talked about, how this thing would work differently in different settings. It also allows you to learn more about heterogeneity of treatment effects. So most of the time, we estimate average treatment effects, but this is not necessarily because we care about average treatment effects. This is just because that's all the data that we have. And then also, it helps you learn potentially more about the mechanisms why this treatment had this effect. OK, so that's a little bit about running experiments. So I'm going to skip the mass collaboration. But I will just say, in one word, I guess, Wikipedia. Wikipedia is really cool. It shows what a bunch of people can do together. What enabled Wikipedia was not new knowledge, but it was a new system of collaboration. And all the time, social scientists collaborate. Like, we work with our students, we work with our colleagues, but you usually work in small teams. So what would happen if we could collaborate in much bigger teams, teams like on the scale of Wikipedia? Then what are the kind of intellectual challenges that we could address? So in this chapter, I have some ideas about that. And I don't have time to talk about them, but you can check it out in the book. So one thing I definitely want to talk about, though, is ethics, because I think this is something that, as computational social scientists, this is something that we have to address. So my experience as a, you know, in social science, a lot of researchers tend to think, oh, ethics, that's something the IRB worries about. As long as I follow the rules, then I'm OK. Ethics is not really a thing that I have to think deeply about. And my experience has been that in computational social science, that is a somewhat of a dangerous attitude. That oftentimes researchers are working in settings where the rules and norms are not clear, and researchers can accidentally do stuff that they really regret afterwards. And so I think there's this fundamental challenge that the capabilities of researchers are changing and increasing faster than the rules and norms are increasing. So you have this real mismatch that people have these capabilities and are not quite sure how they should be used. So in the chapter of my book, I describe some principles that I think we can follow. So I think the trick is to move away from a rules-based approach to a principles-based approach. To continue to follow the rules, but also have a principles-based approach that helps us then talk to each other about what we're doing and explain what we're doing to the public. So when stuff happens that people don't like, and we say, oh, we're doing this because it's allowed by the rules, that is not a very compelling explanation to people, and that's not a very good way for us to actually figure out what we want to be doing. So the way that we figure stuff out is we talk about it with each other, and we try to develop vocabulary and frameworks that help us do stuff. And so here, I think there are already existing principles that have been developed in the research ethics community that can help us reason more clearly. They don't tell it that it's not like a lot of some computer scientists say, like, I want an algorithm to tell me what's ethical or not ethical. And that doesn't exist. But what these principles can help you do is clarify what are the trade-offs. So they help you think about, well, if I do this, that I'm going to sacrifice on this principle, but I'm going to gain on this principle. And then how you do that trade-off, that is up to you, but that's also then what you can explain to other people. You can say, I thought about that. I decided to do this because it's the right balance between these principles. But a lot of that is complicated. So I think the one thing that is not complicated, I think one thing, if you have to remember one thing about ethics, I think it can come from this Spider-Man comic book. So this is the end of the very first Spider-Man. And that's Peter Parker, and his Uncle Ben has just died, and he's walking off into the sunset, and he says, with great power, there must also come great responsibility. So as a sociologist, I generally don't feel very powerful. But increasingly, researchers in collaboration with companies and governments have the ability to observe millions of people's behavior without their consent, without their awareness. We have the ability to run experiments on millions of people without their consent and without their awareness. This is a responsibility, and this is power over these people's lives. And this has to come with a sense of increased responsibility. And I think we're doing that, and I'm happy to see that there's a lot of these discussions are starting to happen in the computational social science space. So that's a little bit about the book. After I finished writing the book, I sent it to my publisher, and then I also posted the entire contents of the book online. So anyone can go right now and read and participate in the open review of the book. So in parallel to traditional peer review, we also do an open review where anyone can read and help make it better, and then I'll take the feedback from the open review and the feedback from peer review and produce a final manuscript. So in addition to these annotations, we're also collecting data on, for example, how people are actually interacting with the book, so like reader analytics data, all the kind of stuff that you would think one would do as a computational social scientist, that's what we're doing.
Is that part of is there an accept button you have to push when you start?
So we have a process where we explain the data that we're collecting. And I'm very public about what we're doing. So one of the principles under the ethical principles under respect for law and public interest from the Menlo Report, they talk a lot about transparency-based accountability. I am not hiding what I'm doing here. And in fact, I'm trying to make it easier for other people to do this. So we've just released this open review toolkit. So this enables anyone to put their own book through open review. It's a set of open source software scripts that will take your manuscript and turn it into an open review website. And the goals here are to get better books, higher sales, and increased access to knowledge. So there's a lot of movement around open access in the journal space, and I think that's awesome. I'm a big fan of that. And I think I see less movement in academic books. And so I think that's one of the big next frontiers for the open access movement. And I think we can do that open access in a way that actually leads to better books and also does not threaten sales. Actually, I think can lead to higher sales. So I tried to set this up in a way that's friendly to authors, and publishers and the general public. So you can go on GitHub and download all the code. So that's a little bit about the book, and I hope you'll go and read and participate. Thank you. Yeah, I'm not beginning to suggest there are easy answers. So I think that one challenge is that it seems like ideally researchers would follow the same set of principles whether they were in a university or in a company. So researchers are in universities, at least in the US, are bound by the common rule. This is a set of US regulations. Researchers in companies are not automatically bound by that. I think this is one reason to think about these principles, because I think the principles can be applied in a variety of settings, whether you work in a company or in a university or in a government. And how people will balance these principles will depend some on the setting, but this will at least help people make clear what the trade-offs that they're willing to make.
Do you have any suggestions for policies or a way we can increase transparency?
Yeah. So I think, so one idea is to try to regulate or have laws by the government to encourage the kinds of behavior that we think is important. I think that will be very difficult. So what I would hope will happen is that we will see a race to the top. So we will see some companies that will make it one of their distinctive selling points that they are responsible in the way they handle people's personal data. That, I think, there's a strong business case to make for that. So if you think most, I don't know if there's anyone here from Amazon, but the Echo and the Google Home are both in-home assistants. So they're potentially collecting a lot of very sensitive data. They have very similar capabilities. And so what is a distinguishing feature that you could use to say you should use this one instead of this one? I think responsible handling of data is potentially a business advantage. So my hope is that some company will take this up and say, this is part of what we do as a company. And then other companies, I hope, will be forced to respond. That is my hope for how it can happen. And so if you work at a company, you can try to start this process at your company. But it's really hard. Yeah? Yeah, so I think one way that researchers can help facilitate that is through the thing that we do a lot of, which is teaching. So I think that there's a lot of stuff that people can do with data that many parts of the public do not understand. So for example, I think the recent research on the difficulty of anonymizing data. So this is very surprising to people that even if you've taken their name off the data, it's possible for an adversary to bring in outside information and re-identify the data. So I think that as more and more people understand this, then we may see changes in how people think some about what they would like their data to have. In the long run, I think that through this education and increased awareness, it's going to take a long time. I'm not saying that this is going to change things overnight, but what is it that researchers can do? One of the things that we almost all of us have to do is teach. And so we can incorporate this into our teaching. So I teach an undergraduate class about social networks. We read the Facebook Emotional Contagion paper. And I have all the students write like an op-ed for the newspaper about what they think about that particular experiment. So it makes them more aware of what's happening. It helps them be able to exercise their preferences more once they know more about what's happening. Yeah? Yeah. So I wrote a book. I posted the entire contents of the book online. I've machine translated the book into 100 languages so that people in other, and so I'm trying. I'm out here giving talks. I'm doing the best I can. I'm trying. I agree. It's not a perfect answer. Yeah? And then. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Sure. So, I think that trying to learn about the world, research is research, whether you're doing it in a company or you're doing it in a university. And so, what I would say to people in companies, what I have said to them is I think there's big gains to being more thoughtful about what you're doing. So I think the social norms experiment is a good example of that, whereby having, like, scientists have developed this, you know, the scientific method to try to figure out how to learn about the world. And, like, that's a recipe that's very valuable kind of no matter what you're trying to figure out. And so I think that by thinking about what you're doing more abstractly, you can actually make a lot more progress than if you're sort of trying to do incremental hill climbing through A/B testing. So that's one point. And then I would also say I think there's a lot of hopefully opportunities for researchers in universities and researchers in companies to collaborate. I think that there's a lot of the data from these companies is not going to leave the companies. I think there's legal reasons why that's not going to happen. There's business reasons. There's ethical reasons. And so another model is researchers moving to data. So the model that a lot of researchers have is, oh, just send me the data. I think that's not feasible. So another model is researchers moving to data. So a lot of companies have summer internship programs for graduate students. They have sabbatical programs for faculty. And then I think there are a variety of questions that are really in what's called Pastor's Quadrant. Do you guys know this idea? So, like, basically, a lot of some people think that there's this big difference between basic, pure research and applied research. And I think that as a one-dimensional continuum is not really the right way to think about the world. And that really there's research that's motivated by use or not motivated by use, and research that seeks fundamental understanding or does not seek fundamental understanding. And so I think there's a lot of use-motivated research that can seek fundamental understanding. So the fact that a lot of the research that happens in companies is use-motivated doesn't necessarily mean it doesn't have to seek fundamental understanding. So that topology I just described is called Pastor's Quadrant from a book by Donald Stokes. And a lot of people inside of tech companies talk about this as a model for the kind of research that they want to do. And so I think academics can be a part of that because I think there are people inside of tech companies that want to do this work that seeks fundamental understanding. Yeah? Yep.
So I'd like to circle back to that. You said surveys are very useful in that data science is still not the need for surveys. So the question I have for you is, looking back what happened to you last week, the last
Yep.
We had tons of surveys in one way.
Yep.
And I think everyone was pretty confused.
Yep. Yep. Yep, yep. That's a great question. So I think the total survey error framework, so this is a framework that survey researchers have developed over a very long period of time, suggests there's kind of two baskets of problems. And one of those problems is in the problem of representation, so like who we actually talk to and whether those people are reflective of everyone in the world, in the voting population. And so these are representation problems. The second problem are problems of measurement. So this is whether we actually successfully saw into their head or not. So for example, let's imagine that I ask Tyler who he's going to vote for, and maybe he doesn't feel comfortable telling me the truth. That would be a measurement problem. Let's imagine that Emma just never answers her phone, and so we can never reach her through a telephone-based survey. That's a representation problem. And so a lot of the problems that could have happened fall into one of these buckets. People might not have told the truth. people might have told the truth but then changed their opinion as the election got closer. People may have said they were going to vote and didn't vote. People may have said they weren't going to vote and did vote. And maybe people who have cell phones are harder to reach. There's a number of problems. So I think that it's going to take time to figure out exactly what those things happened. But I think this doesn't necessarily mean that we should stop asking people questions. It means that we have to figure out how a way to ask people questions that helps them answer honestly, and there's a lot of research about that, and that we do our sampling effectively, even in an age where not everyone has landline telephones. So there's a big set of research about this as well. So I think this is, it was clearly a failure in this case, but I don't think that means that surveys in general are not a good idea. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you had built a model that said that 49% of people were going to buy your product and in reality 51%
yep.
of people buy your product, you did that really good.
Yes. No, no, so I agree. So there's another issue of how much we expect out of the polls, and I do think it's a very challenging thing to expect them to be very cheap and incredibly precise. I think that we could maybe think about whether that's a realistic expectation, especially when so many elections seem to be close. Yeah?
Do you have any examples of particularly bad instances where 30 people don't have non-foo-foo data or any that you might predict happening in the future?
Yeah, so in the book I have some examples of, I guess one example that I think is kind of interesting. There's a bunch of, a researcher, so they got a bunch of data from pagers, like this tells you how old the study was. Pagers are these little things that you would wear. So they got a bunch of pagers where people were sending basically like SMSs through pagers right around the time of the September 11th attack, so on September 11th. So normally when people study people's reactions to tragedies, they have to survey people and it's like long after the event has happened. So here they had all these text messages that were essentially all happening during the day. And so then they used a sort of natural language processing technique called LUC. This is like basically assigned sentiment to the different texts. And they show that it looked like anger increased dramatically throughout the day, but other emotions like fear, and I forgot what the other ones, didn't seem to increase a lot during the day. So they were like, this is great. We have this very high resolution timeline, and they had this. It was actually amazing. It was like this event happened, like the first plane, the second plane, then President Bush speaks, and like it very high resolution. So it's kind of an interesting result. And then about a year later, someone published a paper saying, actually, all those angry, supposedly angry text messages, they were generated by one single pager. And it said something to the effect of server XYZ down critical. And so critical, using Luke, comes off as being an angry word. And so if you take out this one pager, which is clearly about some server failure, then this effect goes away. And so I think that, you know, I don't mean to pick on this particular researcher. Then in response, they did a bunch of other things to try to do an even better job. But I think it's a good illustration of the dangers of not understanding how your data was created. So if you create the data yourself, then you know how that data is created. If you don't create that data yourself, you really need to understand how it was created. And that is a big challenge when you're working with data that comes from these systems that are incredibly opaque.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. Absolutely. So there, I think there's a very there's a technique that survey researchers have used for a long time that I think can be very helpful for dealing with this non-representative data, and that technique is called post-stratification. So essentially, it's a weighting technique where you say sort of the less likely someone is to be in your data, the more weight that they get. So then this is a very well-established technique, and you can prove theorems about it and so on, but you have to then figure out what the right weight should be. So then this is the big challenge. And so here, what you can do is you essentially bringing in auxiliary data, other kinds of data, that can help you figure out what the weight should be. And in the book, in the chapter on surveys, I have this example of this survey that was done of people on the Xbox by a group at Microsoft Research that had, and so they have this very non-random sample of people from the Xbox, so it's very young and very male, and then they do this very a post-stratification technique, and they're able to get estimates that were better than the estimates from traditional telephone surveys. And one of the things that's really cool is that one of the ways they were able to do better, I think, is that the more data you have, the better you can do post-stratification, because the smaller you can make the post-stratification cells. So sometimes big data, like having lots of data, doesn't really make a difference. In this case, having lots of data changes the assumptions that you need to make. It allows you to make weaker and more reasonable assumptions. So I think that's a very promising technique. Yes, so this is another thing. Yes. Yes, absolutely. Post-stratification is not perfect, but one thing that we've seen in a lot of these examples, if you have some data, post-stratification usually moves you closer to the right estimate in cases where you've done it and there is some gold standard measurement that you can compare to. So it's not perfect. It's a step in the right direction. And there are new ways of doing post-stratification that are more designed for very large data sets, like model-based post-stratification, multi-level regression post-stratification, I think is a very exciting technique.
Thanks, Matt.
Cool. Thank you.